the nature of war has changed. And it's changed because of technology. We have aircraft carriers and big fighters and missiles. That was how you won the wars of the 20th century. It's not how you win the wars of the 21st century.
When we brought together the combination of encrypting data and cryptocurrencies for the sake of payment, we created this perfect storm whereby ransomware was able to take off. When you think about how fragile this actually is, it's something that people ought to be losing sleep about.
What's after ransomware? The answer is more ransomware. We will just see bigger, more dangerous attacks put on victims so they feel there is no light at the end of the tunnel other than paying.
The way that the attackers are engaging their victims is much more hands-on. In order to respond to this human element, we need to combat it with a human skill set.
Companies should reconsider security and leverage the resources at their disposal to protect themselves.
Today's companies and economy depend on the ability to safely transmit data, everything from the transactions that we're engaging in to our personal records. With the advent of cryptocurrency, it offers unique opportunity for illicit actors to transfer value across borders with speed that was not previously possible. However, with that comes a loss of anonymity. They get paid and they receive those crypto, and then they begin to move that through a series of wallets and services in an attempt to obfuscate the trail. And that's what makes blockchain analytics so fascinating, because we can literally follow those digital breadcrumbs until they ultimately get it to a place where they hope that it's safe and they can cash it out and turn it into things in the real world.
So what we're looking at is payments being made to a NetWalker ransomware wallet.
I'm Jackie Burns Koven. I lead cyber threat intelligence at Chainalysis, a blockchain forensics company. I track ransomware threat actors and their enablers on the blockchain. Ransomware threat actors are seeking Bitcoin in most cases as part of their extortion campaigns. I'm looking for what types of services that actor uses to launder the funds. All I need is an address, the extortion address.
When you want to buy cryptocurrency or you want to sell cryptocurrency and you want to exchange for real money, you're usually going to go to exchangers. And exchangers are well established, are very well regulated. If law enforcement notices that a criminal went to an exchanger to do any sort of transaction, they can subpoena the exchanger for such information. However, there will be other services that actually provide you over-the-counter, off-record transaction, but this will still be available in the blockchain, obviously.
What we can see in the financial forensics is that they're using the same cash out points, they're using the same wallets. That is a lens that traditionally cyber threat analysts hadn't been looking at the problem set through. Cryptocurrency is being used more as an IOC, an indicator of compromise. And we're seeing that this is a small ecosystem. There's a small number of individuals who are actually responsible for the majority of these attacks. When the pieces start falling into place, being able to map out the entire ecosystem and then seeing where they cash out, you're like, gotcha.
How can we fight cybercrime while supporting civil liberties? The first thing I would say is there has to be constraints. Our politicians and leaders will run roughshod over our civil liberties with every chance that they can get. Companies like Chainalysis are a net negative for society because people's financial privacy is violated. They help law enforcement look at the financial activity of Americans in a way that's tilting us basically towards mass surveillance. These are private things that no government or corporation should know about unless you choose to disclose it.
I don't think people are really paying attention to the size of the dark web's economy of scale. According to the World Economic Forum, $1.5 trillion is stolen from the global economy every year because of cybercrime cartels. Look at North Korea. How are they building those missiles? Those missiles that are Russian-designed missiles. They're paying for that in stolen virtual currency and stolen proceeds of cybercrime. We must assume that the adversary already has a footprint in some system internal to us and is spreading like a disease.
We're always gonna have crime and ransomware and theft, and we're gonna have to do our best as a society to fight that stuff. But in my opinion, the answer is definitely not mass surveillance and warrantless financial spying in the form of Chainalysis. That's not the answer for me.
In my experience, prevention and an investment in prevention is always the best path. When you look at solutions of securing your network, that goes a long way to preventing. It's always easier to prevent a spill than clean up a spill. Waiting until you've become a victim and then trying to clean it up through paying a ransom, that money probably would have been better well spent long before that. Maybe you wouldn't have been a victim at all.
When you think about some of the critical infrastructure that exists in just about every country, it's alarmingly simple for attackers to be able to start taking out the systems that we rely on to just keep the world around us running. Look at some of the basic protocols that are the backbone of the internet today. These have been around 30, 40 years in some cases. These things were never designed with security concerns in mind. We can't dismantle or shut down the internet so that we can build the next version of it.
In March 2020, I accepted a new position as the CIO of a large amenity management company undergoing a massive digital transformation. We had over 40 offices scattered throughout North America. You end up inheriting a lot of legacy technologies and legacy processes. Unfortunately, we got hit with a cyber attack. Got a call from my IT director. He was explaining that he was witnessing our file share being encrypted in front of his eyes. Our weakest link in the organization wasn't our systems. It wasn't our processes. It was people.
No matter what IT security professional you talk to, majority of them say that their weakest link, no matter how expensive their firewall is, how great their security software is, they still support users. They're the ones that click on things, they're the ones that bring ransomware in, opening emails or accessing files or going to websites that may not look 100% correct.
Ransomware is all about the weakest link in the chain. And if one link breaks, they're in. You've now infected tons of people.
We bring a lot of legacy into the current state with us. We don't take seriously how people actually interact with each other, let alone with technology.
And the more complex our IT systems become, the more likely it is events are going to occur. And our best chance for being able to prevent these things from happening is to ensure that we've got teams of people who are monitoring what the products are telling us.
Experienced personnel watching your environment, every machine, looking for the warning signs. This will give you the visibility to react prior to the attack rather than after it.
Cybercrime has become very much a commodity. There's a lot of toolkits, frameworks, infrastructure. The barrier to entry has become very low, and a lot of these tools don't take a lot of sophistication or skills to execute.
There's been a lot of discussion about the personalization of warfare. The problem with ransomware is a lot of the effects are not clear right from the beginning, so it's not like a kinetic attack.
Hackers are pretty careful of staying below a threshold. That threshold is the use of force. How far can I push without triggering kinetic conflict or a nuclear conflict? The rule in cyber warfare is stay below that threshold, and it makes it really hard for your democratic opponents to respond to you. The U.S. has the most powerful conventional military in the world, and that has a little bit of an effect on making people think twice before they smack us. But over time, Russia and China have concluded that maybe we're overrated, and so they've become more aggressive. We will have to change how we engage with our opponents.
I think it's wrong just to look at the ransom. The broader picture is the data, the value that that has, and what stance a nation should be taking to protect. there needs to be a fundamental recognition that the data that we hold is really, really valuable. Focusing just on whether ransom should or not be paid, it's missing the crucial element.
This really isn't a business problem anymore. This is a humanity problem. There's a lot of challenges interfacing with people, and at the end of the day, businesses are made of people. The financial impacts of these types of attacks can really set companies back, might be the difference between staying in business or not.
CEOs of companies are hoping that it's not going to happen to me. Well, hope is not a strategy. Okay, so you have to be prepared for when it's going to happen.
To think that anyone is immune is to fool ourselves about security. What we can do is try to make ourselves more difficult. So if you can make your defenses more and more that they may focus elsewhere, that's one of your main goals.
If we compare the underground economy and where we have the crime as a service, probably the same model has to come into the cybersecurity as well. So you need to have cybersecurity as a service.
The internet is a 24/7 game, and a lot of businesses don't run a 24/7 business. You can hire and outsource this team that provides that expertise and the people sitting behind the technology to make sure that the technology works.
We're starting to see progression towards more of this combination of technology and services. It means you have confidence that you're not being exposed to risks you haven't adequately anticipated.
Most companies can't afford the resources that are necessary to fight the sophisticated hackers that are sitting on the other side, and yet their data is worth protecting. Working together to pool those resources, not just through an insurance, but through actual cybersecurity, that's changed the game completely.
I would ask all of you to challenge your bosses, the companies you do business with, and the policymakers to not only invest more in cybersecurity, but really take it as a priority to root out these rogue nation states that have set up shop.
This is no longer a question of awareness. This is a question of importance. We're going to continue to leverage advances in technologies to our advantage, and we are making progress. So are the attackers. We just need to make sure that there are more of us doing more good work than there are of them.